How to get rid of spam emails. Hi everyone, Leo Notenboom here for askleo.com. Ask Leo is sponsored in large part by my patrons. Thank you if you are such a patron. If not, consider helping us out and getting access to patron exclusive content on askleo.com, including an ad-free experience when you visit the site. Visit askleo.com/patron to learn more. Sign up today. Spam. It's the scourge of the century, it seems. Everybody gets spam. Everybody fights with spam. Spam is ubiquitous. It's amazing sometimes to think about what the world would be like if it weren't for spam, if spam didn't exist. But it's here and we have to deal with it. So what do you do about it? Well, if you take away nothing else from what I'm about to tell you, let it be this. You can't stop spam. You cannot prevent people from sending you email. Period. The only thing you can do is manage it. And what that means is what happens to it after it arrives. A properly working spam solution works this way. All of the email you want shows up in your inbox. All of the email you don't want, all of the spam, shows up in your spam or junk folder. That is a working system. And if we could rely on that being 100% accurate all the time, then we'd be done. Because honestly, you would never look at your junk folder. You would only look at your inbox and you'd get on with your life. It would be as if spam didn't exist. Unfortunately, things aren't that simple. It's a battle. It's an ongoing battle. Spammers get better. Spam filters get better. You get the idea. So sometimes spam makes it into your inbox, and sometimes legitimate email gets filtered into your spam folder. Here's some of the things you can do to manage the flood. And that's what it boils down to. Not stopping spam, but managing it. First, understand that spam filters are our first best line of defense against spam. These are filters that read each email as it comes in, looking for spammy topics, spammy phrases, things that would indicate that this particular message is in fact unsolicited spam. That could be the topic of the email, it could be who it seems to come from, information buried in the headers, certain ways of using HTML or rich text messages, email from IP addresses that have a bad reputation for sending spam. If anything that could contribute to this message being spam counts as a strike against it. It's not absolute. This is not, unfortunately, an exact science. So one of the first things that you need to do is understand how your spam filter works and how good it is. For the most part, what that means is, ideally, selecting an email provider that has a good spam filter to begin with. This is one of the reasons I use Gmail, because it is currently, and has been for several years, the best spam filter that I'm aware of. And then training the spam filter. Most spam filters have the option for you to, when a message appears in your inbox, mark it as spam. Or when a message that you should have gotten shows up in your spam folder, you have the option to say, no, this is not spam. This is not junk. Doing both of those things is very, very important because, in theory, it trains the spam filter. It tells the spam filter, to me, messages that look like this are not spam, or messages that look like this are spam. The bottom line is the spam filter is going to learn more and more of what you consider to be spam and not spam, and factor those into its calculations. It's not absolute. It is one factor of many. Which is one of the reasons I say repeatedly marking something as spam or not spam just raises the importance of your opinion in the complex calculation that goes on when a spam filter works. Unfortunately, many other aspects of the email may be so overwhelming that your opinion may not count, or may not count as much as you think it does. That's one of the reasons that I've seen people complain that they mark something as spam over and over and over again, and yet it's still showing up in their inbox. Well, there's some other characteristic of that email that is probably being taken into a higher consideration. Keep doing what you're doing. Eventually, hopefully, your opinion will matter more. But until that time, these other characteristics of the messages are kind of overwhelming what it is your opinion might say. That's especially true of email that shows up in your spam folder. Occasionally, my newsletter will show up in a spam folder. Mark it as not spam. There's some characteristic, be it the sender, be it some word that I happen to use, be it something that was so, I won't say overwhelming, but just enough to tip the scales into the analyzer thinking that it's spam and therefore throwing it into the spam folder. So first things first, understand your spam filter, understand how it works, and most important of all, understand how to mark something as spam that shouldn't be in your inbox and how to mark something as not spam that shows up in your spam folder. A common technique that many people use to try to manage spam is to use multiple email addresses. This is actually not a bad solution, but again, it's not absolute. You will have one primary email address that you guard. You'll hand it out only to individuals that you trust or services that you trust. And then you will create throwaway email addresses for other things. So you might say, make an online purchase using one of these throwaway email addresses. And once you start getting spam on that email address, well, you stop using it. The problem is, again, it's not absolute. You will get email spam on your primary email address. You just will. If you're not getting spam today, you're going to get it sooner or later, even on that most protected of email accounts. One of the reasons, of course, is that those are the email accounts we use at banks and online services. And those are the places that occasionally get hacked. That hack, it may not expose your password, which is great, but it almost always exposes your email address. All of a sudden, hackers have this nice long list of email addresses to which to send spam. So it's a fine technique. It's just not something I would rest my hopes on being tremendously effective when it comes to protecting a primary email address. Another approach that people use is something called challenge response. Now, my bias here is very simple. I hate challenge response. I really don't like it. Here's what it is, and you've probably seen it. If you send an email message to someone that you've never emailed before, rather than that message being delivered to them, you will get a message in return. It's called a challenge. They will ask you to do something. It may be as simple as click a link. It may be as complicated as solving a CAPTCHA, but it is something that says, yes, I'm a real person, and I really intend for this email to go through. Once you've successfully completed that challenge with your response, then your original email message is finally delivered. Now, the good news about challenge response is that it's actually quite effective. Spammers don't handle the challenge. They just don't, which means that you're not going to get any spam. The problem is that you're not going to get a lot of other things as well. People whose email newsletters you might sign up for, they're not going to respond to the challenge. If you get email from your bank or from any automated system that's important to you, they're not going to respond to the challenge. You will have to explicitly allow list those email addresses, assuming you even know what they are. Now, there are usually additional steps that you can take to make sure you understand, okay, here's a bunch of email addresses that have been blocked by this. Oh, this one should have gone through. It's all extra work. Maybe you like it. Maybe you don't. I don't, because to my way of thinking, it places the burden of spam on the people who are legitimately trying to send you email. They pay the price where they shouldn't have to. So It's something that's out there. It's not terribly uncommon, but it's not something that I can honestly, truly recommend. Now, there are things called allow and deny lists. These are lists that you specify with your email provider. Each basically does what the name implies. An allow list is a list of email addresses that should never be sent to spam. If the email comes from that email address, never send that to spam. Similarly, if an email address is on a block list, that email should never go into your inbox. It may go automatically to spam, or it may just not be delivered at all. But being on a block list means email from that address should never show up in your inbox one way or another. The problem with email block lists especially is that spammers know this. They never send their message from the same email address twice. That's what botnets are for. They send email addresses from spoofed email addresses with everyone being different. So the fact that you blocked one email address doesn't mean you're going to have any impact on the wave of spam that seems to be headed your way, because they're all going to be coming from different addresses. It just doesn't work anymore. It used to, it was fine, but it just doesn't work anymore. Allow lists are a little bit better in the sense that, yeah, sometimes if someone, for whatever reason, maybe they happen to use an email service with a bad reputation, or they consistently talk about topics that would potentially be considered spammy, by putting them on an allow list, you'll at least allow them to bypass the whole spam detection algorithm, if your service even has an allow list. Services like Gmail, you do it all through filters. Services like Outlook.com, you have those lists, but they're limited in how many addresses you can put on them. Other services, other programs have different mechanisms and different limitations on those mechanisms. So the bottom line is, there's no perfect bottom line. There just isn't. Spam is. We all get it. We all struggle with it to some degree. And unfortunately, what I see is a lot of people stressing out over it. You're stressing yourself into a heart attack, to be honest, because there's no point. There really is no point in stressing out about it. The important things to do are to learn the nuances of your available spam filters, train them, use how to use an allow list, use how to use a block list if it's available. To the extent that you can, maybe protect your primary email address. Make sure that you're checking your spam folder occasionally for false positives. I do it maybe once a day, and it's a really quick scan. It's like rip through that. I don't see anything I recognize, and then I will immediately empty my spam folder because I know I've checked those. Same thing, if you get spam in your inbox, don't stress. Mark it as spam, delete it, and move on. And of course, never mark as spam email that you actually asked for. If you asked for it, by definition, it's not spam. You should unsubscribe from that. I've got articles on that topic. And finally, if you have the opportunity to make a change to your email service, your email provider, whatever, consider the quality of the spam filter that you're moving yourself into. Some programs are better than others. Some services are better than others. As I mentioned earlier, today, as I write this, and for the last few years, Gmail, for all the other warts they may have, probably has the best spam filter that I've encountered to date. I hope that was helpful. I hope this helps you stress out a little bit less about spam and know that it's not just you. We're all dealing with it, and the best way to deal with it is to simply delete it and move on. For updates, for comments, for related links and more, visit askleo.com/1880. I'm Leo Notenboom. This is askleo.com. Thanks for watching.